We greet all of you tonight. We're thankful that you're with us. Because it is good and pleasant for brethren to dwell together in unity. Amen. Particularly welcome our visitors tonight. What was your last name again?
Smith.
One of those rare names, yes. Well, we're thankful. We're thankful to meet a brother and sister of Smith and family, yes. And we appreciate your faith very much. We've heard of it. We're in the book of Genesis. Actually, we've completed 83 lessons in it, and this is, we're going through an overview because of some things I wanted to make a note of that are common in them. I felt for a long time the book of Genesis has been unduly neglected and seriously misunderstood, but it's a foundational book. Now, these lessons that we handed out, we're not going to cover everything in them, therefore you to take home. But on this second review, we're going to deal, the first one we dealt with words that were introduced in Genesis. I want to enlarge that a little bit to some concepts that were never heard of till Genesis was written. And everyone realized that Genesis was written 2,000 years after it started. It was a revelation backwards, which is quite remarkable.
Yeah.
It's so much history. Moses lived about 2,000 years after Adam. So all that period of time, this is what God wanted you to know about that period of time. What's in Genesis? Well, there's a whole lot that happened, you know. People have predicted and estimated how many people died in the flood. We have no idea. But it was a lot more than people think. I believe I brought to your attention that if the human race doubled every year, that'd be a kind of a modest increase. If they doubled every year until the year of the flood, which is a little after 1600. Now, I know a lot of people died, but if they didn't die, we're talking about a trillion people.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Check it out yourself. I'm telling you the truth.
Yeah.
So this is a lot. No one had, and they didn't have all the oceans and all the bodies of water and all that didn't exist, and the whole earth was habitable. They didn't have ice poles. So that's a significant thing God wanted you to know. If you think God can't get angry, well, think again. Think again. And the flood was nothing to be compared to when Jesus comes. Then we're going to see the world's already been baptized with water. It's going to be baptized with fire.
Yeah, amen.
At any rate, the book of Genesis is a very important book, and we're going to deal with some of the concepts. By a concept, I mean a valid body of thought. There are vain concepts. Men have ideas that are baloney and cheap baloney at that. But the ideas that are expressed in Genesis are ideas he'll use all through the rest of human history. Now, if you don't know what that was back in Genesis, you won't have the faintest idea what like a sacrifice is. If you don't know Genesis, you don't have any idea what sacrifice means. And you can't look at Webster's. It's not going to tell you. It's going to tell you a surface view only. So there's some things that just in general we might observe at this time, just some general things we found out in Genesis. We found out that God is only pleased by what he makes.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
Now, you want to digest that. Mm-hmm. Remember, he saw the creation. Oh, it was very good. Yeah. He said, this is good. Well, he said, it's good. Mm-hmm. Then it was all over, wrap up. He said, very good. He never says that of anything that he doesn't do.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
If you are a good faith, good and faithful servant is because God worked in you. That's why. And we learn that God does not allow his purposes to be interrupted by Satan. Satan tried to interrupt. Remember that first promise God ever gave was to the devil. He said, the seed of woman is going to bruise your head, and so forth. And Satan tried all through the book of Genesis to interrupt that, but God doesn't allow Satan to interrupt his purpose. So if you can ever get in the flow of God's purpose, you are safe.
Yeah, that's right.
Believe me. We learn that God is the one that makes alive, and the reason he does is so there can be fruitfulness.
That's right.
From everything from grass to animals. That's the purpose for life. The purpose for life is fruit.
Yeah, that's right.
Offspring. And God never promises something he doesn't intend to fulfill. Whether it's a promise of condemnation, he that believes not shall be condemned. You know, that's a promise. But whatever God promises, it's just not talk. See, men just talk. They jabber. And you can't take a half of what they say for granted. But somehow people have got the idea that God talks this way. Because every day there's things God has condemned that are going on. And people know that God said something about it, but they just don't think he's serious. But he is. He's serious about it. And God reminds people of what he said. Particularly the promises. He promised Abraham once, and over and over and over he missed it, and he missed it over and over to Isaac, and over to Jacob, and over. God reminds people of what he promised. Why? Because when sin and death entered the world, man began to forget. Forgetfulness plagues man. God cannot and will not ignore sin. He will not. He will not. If you sin, God won't pretend like you didn't.
Right.
You got to settle this in your mind. Adam and Eve just did one sin that's recorded. That's the only, I'm sure Adam and Eve sinned more, but the only one sin's recorded, and it was just eating a piece of fruit. One time.
Yeah.
That's all God. He doesn't forget about sin, doesn't ignore it. That's why we thank God for forgiveness. See, God's not going to ignore sin. He has made provision in Christ to forgive sin.
Yeah.
But he will not ignore it.
Yeah.
And sometimes it just heaps up in the day of judgment. It's going to heap up in a whole God. People are going to get the whole dose of God's wrath. Because they kept on living, thinking God. We learn that God's the principal worker in the world. And his purpose is the purpose that will stand.
Mm-hmm.
We learn that divine examination is always followed by some kind of judgment, either a blessing or a curse. If God pays attention, if he puts his eyes on what you're doing, he's going to do something about it.
Yeah.
And this is bad for the sinner, this is good for the saint. Circumstances, we learn in Genesis that circumstances are controlled by God.
Mm-hmm.
He can decide when it's going to rain, how much it's going to rain, and when it stops raining.
Yeah.
That's God now.
Amen.
God determines circumstances. So if you're griping about your circumstances, like, stop.
Amen.
God's governing circumstances. What about the devil? He works for God.
Yes.
He doesn't do it willingly. I mean, I understand that. We learn that those who are chosen by God can survive the circumstances. Whether it's a famine or an army or malicious brothers or prison, or if God's chosen somebody, they can survive the circumstances. We learn in Genesis that those chosen by God can resist and survive very strong circumstances. Joseph, for instance, didn't have a Bible. In fact, he didn't have very much at all when he was in Egypt in Pharaoh's house. He had a chance of a carnal lifetime. Real famous woman, mm-hmm. probably good looking, nobody'd know mm-hmm. except God.
Yeah.
And Joseph, with as little as he knew, and he didn't know as much as any 3 or 4 year old child uh-huh. knows sitting in this room.
Yeah.
He didn't know that much,
yeah.
and he was able to resist
Amen.
The engrossments. We learn that a person can be exalted in the earth and remain pure. Mm-hmm. We have the example in Joseph. Uh-huh. A person can prosper and have extensive progeny or offspring and still be rejected.
Yeah.
Cain, Ishmael, Esau. See, the all nations came from all three of those people. You can learn that God can completely remove the wicked so there's not anyone left. He demonstrated in the flood. He's going to do it one more time, and that's going to be the last time. And God can mandate that a person will survive when there's no way of escape. Noah from the flood, Lot from Sodom. See, when you know these things in your heart, circumstances don't frighten you so much.
Amen.
I'm sorry, but a lot of believers get scared too easy.
Yeah. Amen.
It's very troubling.
Yeah.
This is very troubling to me. Even though there's nothing I can do about it, I know it, but it's very troubling to me to see people that are believers and have been in them for a long time that are scared of just about everything. This is not right. Book of Genesis to teach you that, and there's a whole lot more in the scriptures about it also. And we learn that God does come to the aid of the oppressed. So there's nobody else to help you. Leah was oppressed. You remember Leah? God came to her. He comforted her. Jacob was oppressed by his brothers and by Laban. God came to him. Joseph was oppressed. God, see, so when you're oppressed, help hasn't run out.
Yes, amen.
We learn that God, as great as he is, has profitable dealings. The great God of heaven has profitable dealings with men. He works with them in unusual ways. You've got examples like Noah and so forth. All of that proves that the scriptures are profitable. All scriptures given by inspiration of God and is profitable.
Yeah,
see, so you learn that from this. All right, I want to get into it now. We're going to talk about things that are revealed, made known in Genesis. The first thing we're going to look at is fruit. Fruit. In the creation, we're introduced to fruit.
Mm-hmm.
On the third day, God created the herb-yielding seed and the fruit tree-yielding fruit. See, we're introduced to fruit. It's important because Jesus said, by their fruits.
That's right.
It might amaze you that very few people have taken that seriously. By their fruits. They'll say, why did he do that? How did they survive? See, these kind of questions all the time are being asked by church folk.
Mm-hmm.
So Genesis tells you something about fruit.
Yeah.
Fruit. We learn a couple of things about fruit. Fruit included the seed of the vegetation. It's the seed is in the fruit. So this is the means by which it can perpetuate itself. The fruit was not only for the eater, it was for the plant to perpetuate itself. And the fruit of the vegetation was given to man for nourishment to keep him alive. Fruit, we're introduced to that in Genesis. Right and wrong, in the beginning, right and wrong was established by fruit. The fruit of the tree of life versus the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil.
Yeah.
See, that those two trees defined
yes.
right
uh-huh.
and wrong.
Yeah, amen.
Acceptable, not acceptable. Whatever God gives you is acceptable.
Mm-hmm.
whatever God doesn't give you is unacceptable.
Yeah.
You learn that right there in the beginning. It was not long, perhaps the very day, I think probably the fall happened on the Sabbath day. I wouldn't doubt it. Adam was created on the Sabbath day. I wouldn't doubt that it happened immediately. I can't imagine Satan sitting back in the wings for a while. God told Adam, now if you eat the fruit of this tree, you will surely die. That's plain enough. I mean, any first grade pupil would know what that meant. But Satan, the first try, let me emphasize this, the first try, this wasn't like, it wasn't like 2 weeks of temptation. It was one time, and he just added one word, or five words, thou shalt surely die. Four words, thou shalt surely die. He added one word, made five, thou shalt surely die. See, that doesn't look like a very big addition. But it brought the entire human race down.
Yes, amen.
That one time, one additional word. So if you think you're smart, think again.
Yeah, amen.
Adam was, in the flesh, Adam was the smartest man that ever lived. And he was the only innocent adult that has ever, lived except Jesus. He was totally innocent as a grown man, totally innocent. So we learn this from Genesis. We learn don't underestimate the devil, and don't overestimate your wisdom and your strength. Don't do it. We learn several things from this. Man's blessed or cursed by what he takes into himself. Whatever you eat or consume, you think of it mentally and so forth, whatever you take in, you accept it, you take it in, it will either help you or harm you. It will not be neutral. It will either contribute to your inner health or it will cause it to deteriorate. One or the other. This is what men, see, this is the secret to what men are what they are because of what they consume, what they take in, what they receive, what they believe, what they accept. This is what makes them what they are. So if you feed your mind all the time on the things of the world, all the time, you'll become spiritually stupid. You can't avoid this now. You can't avoid this. If you take in, if you think on things like Philippians 4:8, think on things that are comely and so forth, then this will contribute to your inner health. We also learn that Satan always focuses on what's wrong. Satan never tries to get you to look at what's right. He always focuses on what's wrong. And he always promotes the idea that God isn't seeking your best. You could really be a lot better off if you wouldn't be following God so much. If you just weren't so religious. See, he'll try and convince you of that. We learn that from Genesis. All sin, we learn from Genesis, is self-centered. So every sin, not making a difference what it is, it's self-centered. All sin focuses on you. All good focuses on God. See, it's a big difference. But you learn this from the book of Genesis. You learn that increase always comes from seed, which is found in what we ingest or take in. So when man lives by every word of God, it means you have to take it in. It doesn't mean you just read it. That's not what it means.
Right.
Any school teacher can tell you, you can read, and flunk. Everybody knows this in the flesh, but few people know this in the Lord. What you read, you've got to take in. You've got to ingest it, because the Word of God doesn't do its work in your eyeball. It does it in your heart.
Amen.
Let the Word of Christ dwell richly in your heart.
The sisters years ago told me that she was wrestling with this idea of being in subjection to her husband. And she said, but yet when she read that Christ was subject to God, was made subject to God willingly. She said it delivered her from that temptation to be not in agreement with that, being in subjection with her own husband. And she said, and when that happened, it absolutely freed her up to where she could then do it, you know, willingly, and she had grace to do it. All of life is like that in the spirit. As you see that, you already went over this, as you see that what God's leading you into is really for your best, it really is, but it doesn't seem that way in the flesh.
Amen.
Amen.
And any questions that you have about this, they're all worked out in Scripture.
Yes, amen. That's right.
If someone you're in subjection to, like a king, honor the king, the Scripture says, be subject to governors, the Scripture says. But if the king tells you to worship a statue, you say, not going to do it.
Amen.
If your husband tells you to commit adultery, you say, no, I'm not going to do it.
That's right.
If your parents tell you, don't pray, you're not going to do it.
Yeah.
See, no human command can upstage a divine command.
Yeah, right.
Now, as simple as that seems, there's a lot of people now that have really been hurt because they've been told the wrong thing. I know people that their wives been beat up by their husbands, and some nutcase preacher told her to, you just take it and be in subjection to him. Well, this man needs to go down to Walmart and find a job down there, because this is not right.
That's right.
This no earthly command upstages what God commands.
That's right.
It's just a kind of a principle thing you want to learn. Well, there's mention of fruit in Genesis. There's the fruit tree. Genesis 1:11. Sea creatures were fruitful. Mankind is fruitful. We have our eating fruit. Anyway, I give the list. It says about fruit. There's a lot about fruit in Genesis.
Yeah.
Remember, what we're showing is that these are concepts, that the concept is developed in Genesis. Life. It's a lot about life. Book of Genesis. Life is the means through which identity and expression are achieved. You know what the thing is by its life. Life enables whatever it is, a plant or a person or an animal, to express itself. That's life, does that. The word life in all of its varied forms is used 82 times in Genesis. The first three chapters have 13 references to life. The breath of life was breathed by God into Adam and constituted him a living soul. In the record of Noah's salvation, living creatures were said to have had the breath of life. That's what enabled them to move about. Were fish, they navigated. Life enabled them to navigate, so forth. You find in Genesis that the greatest gift is the gift of life. You're able to survive in the environment in which you were placed. That's what life is. It's what we call reciprocity. If a fish goes in water, the fish was created to live in water. The four-footed beast was created to live on the earth. The fowls are created to live in the air. See, the creatures under the ground, they were created to live under the ground. You were created to live in God, to live and have and move and have your being in Him. You were not created to live in this world, even though this is where you are at the present time. God created life. Life just didn't happen. This is why Darwin was wrong, and everybody who believed him is wrong. Life didn't just happen. Life can't just happen. That's why no evolutionist can tell you when life started. They can say, well, this was a process, and after a long time, you know, this amoeba turned into a man and so forth. But they can't tell you when it, but the scriptures, Genesis tells you when it started.
Amen.
Why should we believe somebody that doesn't know the first evidence of life, doesn't know when the first man was, doesn't know when the first birth was, doesn't know when the first marriage was? Why do we believe them when God's told us all these beginnings? And how could you come up with these? How could anyone come up with what Genesis says? He is all interrelated. It's a very, very intelligent, if you want to say it that way. So life comes from God. God created it. And life must be sustained. If the thing's alive, it's got to be kept alive.
Mm-hmm.
Now, see, there's a lot of theology that denies this. They say, once you're alive, you're always alive. Well, this isn't true of grass. It isn't true of herbs. It isn't true of fruit trees, animals, beasts of the earth. It isn't true of man. No, once you're alive, you're not always alive. Life has to be sustained. If something that's living is not fed, it will die.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Why is it that some people spiritually die or deny the faith or believe for a while, as Luke 8:13 says, and then in time of temptation fall away? Why? Why is it that way? Is it because they didn't do this, they didn't do that? No, it's because they weren't alive.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Some point they died.
Yeah.
Inside, they died. You've probably seen this. I've seen people right before my eyes over a period of time. I saw them dying. Spiritually, I'm talking about. Toward God, they were dying. They weren't eating. They weren't nourishing their soul. Pretty soon, they're just absenting themselves from anything that has to do with God. Pretty soon, they put the Word of God aside. What happens to you? Life has to be nourished. You learn that from Genesis. And only what's alive will grow.
Yeah.
Only what's alive can reproduce.
Yeah.
Brother Matthew.
Yeah, Jesus expressed this when he talked about him being the vine. And he's saying, if you abide in me, then you'll bear much fruit. And Paul also said it doctrinally in the epistles when he said that your life is hid with Christ in God.
Amen.
So at the point in which you died, that connection to the source of life was severed.
Amen. I failed to say this when we started, but this, you're free to say anything and discuss, make an observation during this meeting. So fruitfulness can only be realized when someone's alive. Now, the duration of a person on earth is referred to as the time they were alive. When they died, then their life ended. Now, maybe a person can't receive this, but you don't match your standard of fall. But a person remains in Christ only as long as they're alive.
Yeah. Amen. Yep.
There's no dead person in Christ.
That's right.
Surely no one here believes this. There's nobody dead. Nobody in Christ is dead.
Yeah. Amen.
But there are some people that once were in Christ that are dead.
Mm-hmm.
We know this because Jesus addressed an entire church. Church at Sardis, that entire church, except a few souls.
Mm-hmm.
He said, you say you're alive, you're dead.
Yeah.
They were a real church.
Mm-hmm.
They weren't always dead.
Mm-hmm.
But they died.
Yeah.
On the vine they died.
Yeah. That's right.
See, if I remember right, I believe Jesus said that any branch in me,
yeah.
I think he said, isn't that what he said? Any branch in me doesn't bear fruit.
Yeah.
The Father prunes them off.
Right.
Well, what happened there? They didn't, their life wasn't sustained.
Uh-huh.
See, life has to be sustained.
Uh-huh.
And your lifetime, whether it's your physical life or your spiritual life, is defined by how long you're alive.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Simple, but it's good to know.
Yeah, but given that,
Some people will take that and they'll say, well, see, now we're teaching that we can keep ourselves alive. But see, really, it's as you submit yourself, as you crucify the flesh and submit to God, then He gives you to be alive.
That's exactly
the life is in Christ. It's not in yourself. And that's basically what you just said.
You abide in the
That's
you
right.
Abide
you abide.
He says, abide in me.
Yeah. Amen.
Stay where God put you.
Amen.
When you were coming to Christ, God puts you in Christ. Of
Amen.
God are we in Christ Jesus. So God puts you in Christ. Uh-huh. Now, you've got to stay there. And you can't stay there unless you stay alive, and you can't stay alive unless you listen to the one into whom God has put you.
Amen.
Then there are several examples of life I give you there here in Genesis. Then in Genesis, we're introduced to the idea of death. From the standpoint of death, the first commandment involved avoiding death. That was the first commandment. These two people were alive. I don't think Adam and Eve weren't immortal because they... It's the eat tree of life that kept them
That's
alive.
Right. Yeah.
But that first commandment was don't die. Mm-hmm. If you eat of this, you'll die.
Uh-huh.
I don't think many new Christians are told this.
Yeah.
I don't think they're told, listen, if you hobnob with the people of the world, that's called an unequal yoke in Scripture.
Uh-huh.
You'll die.
That's right.
They won't become alive because you're with them. You'll become dead because you're with them.
That's right.
You've got to really see this.
Yeah.
But I don't believe believers in our time are told this. And some of them discover it after a period of time. They finally find out about it. But this should be told them. Avoid death at all cost.
Yeah.
Avoid dying toward God. Avoid getting in a position where you can't sense whether God's dealing with you or not. Avoid this situation where you don't know whether you're in God's favor or not. Avoid that at all costs.
Amen.
When you first come into Christ, that's not the way you come in.
Uh-huh.
You come in with this, about the only thing you really know is your sins are gone.
Yeah.
Boy, that does a lot for you to know that.
Amen.
So you come in knowing some things. Keep increasing in the sensitivity. Death. You learn about this, that God imposes death on the entire world. When Adam sinned, He imposed death on the entire world, both the personal and impersonal creation. They didn't have any choice in the matter. They didn't have any choice in the matter. Death was imposed on humanity, and death was imposed on the environment where they lived. Now in Genesis, when he talks about death, the phrase "and he died" is mentioned 10 times, and it's mentioned to people that live like 800-900 years. But it comes, "and he died."
Yeah.
So your tenure in the world concludes with "and he died."
Yeah.
Death. Death is also called giving up the ghost or giving up the spirit. So your body isn't what makes you alive. It's your spirit in your body that makes you alive. When the spirit leaves the body, we bury it.
Yeah.
Or some people that have no qualms about it, burn it. Now the fear of death can become an incentive. See, Adam and Eve, they didn't have the fear of death. It was because they didn't understand. I know this. They didn't understand, but you do understand. You do understand that God has said some things that cause spiritual death to you, cause you to die, and you should have a wholesome fear of death.
Amen.
You don't willingly, in the body, you don't willingly subject yourself to an environment where you know you're going to die. Unless you're like a hero saving somebody or something like that, but you don't subject yourself to something that you know is going to kill you. But do you know that a lot of Christians are doing this every day? They're subjecting themselves to defiling and influences that will take their life from them. death is identified as being gathered to his people. As I said, those patriarchs died today, they gave up the spirit and they were gathered to their people. So everyone's going to end up with their own kind of people.
Yes, amen.
Huh? People in hell are going to be with their kind of people. It's going to be a miserable existence, I might mind you. No friends. No one's going to have a friend.
That's right.
In hell. No one will have anything they want. Anything in hell. See?
Yeah.
But then the people of God, they're going to be with their kind of people.
Uh-huh.
Isn't that a pleasant thought?
Amen.
Their kind of people. That's where everyone's headed to this. When you die, everyone's headed to this. They're going to end up with their kind of people. And their kind of people, like the people that are condemned, their kind of people are not only do-gooders, it's like the Hitlers and people like that.
Uh-huh. That's right.
See, it's just not people made mistakes. It's not that.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you live so you can end up with that, with the kind of people? You will company with them here.
Uh-huh.
Spend time with them here.
Mm-hmm.
Love. But the scripture is called the brethren. That's the brothers of Jesus. Love them and spend time with them here, and then you'll be gathered. Those are the people you'll be gathered to in the end. Death.
Brother,
yes.
It's interesting. The scripture says that for those like the patriarchs, they went and were gathered unto their people. But for people that went to hell, it says, and they went to their place.
Mm-hmm. Went to their place, their own place.
I mean, it's a place that you go, but there was no friends in that place. I mean, they weren't
gathered right.
to their people.
Mm. That's right. That's right. That's the way it is now. It's a person can choose to think that that's kind of morose to talk that way, but that's the way it is.
Yeah.
Spiritual death, this is how we all were. When we came to Christ, we were all dead in trespasses and sins, the scripture says. Then there's another thing that's opened up to us in Genesis, a matter of suffering, when people have a lot of trouble with suffering. This philosophical statement is one of the dumbest statements of all times. You know, why do good people suffer? Why do bad things happen to good people? You know, an insult to intelligence to make such a statement. Because where is there a good person something bad hasn't happened to, pray tell? And you can include Jesus in that too.
Right. Uh-huh.
So it's really suffering is introduced to us in the book of Genesis.
I don't think I've ever heard anybody ask, why do good things happen to bad
people? Yeah, that's right. Yeah, that's worthy of asking, that's right. Even the creation suffers. Romans 8, verses 20 and 21 tell you about it, that they groan under the weight of the bondage of corruption.
Right.
A whole creation from the furthest galaxy to the earth and men on it is dying. I know the scientists say that new things are being created every day. But see, they're lying, not telling the truth. First, these people tell us that they're light years away, and it takes 3 million years for whatever's there to become visible here. First they tell us that, and then they say they've actually are witnessing new things being created. Well, I mean, come on. If you could reach and really see that far, probably what you were seeing was the original creation. Anyway, but the point is that creation is in a state of decline because of men's sin.
Yeah.
And suffering is a facet of death.
Mm-hmm.
All suffering is a subcategory
mm-hmm.
of death.
Yeah.
Suffering, disease, deterioration, it all is an aspect of death. If there wasn't any death, there wouldn't be any suffering.
Yeah.
That's why in the glory there'll be no suffering or sorrow or anything like that. This suffering is addressed to the new creation, see. The new creation puts something different in you. It's a workmanship of God, created in Christ Jesus. When you come into Christ, he doesn't take away this body. He is going to in the resurrection. He isn't going to take it away and give you a new one. But he doesn't take it away, but he gives you a new something that won't perish. You've got to keep this. You've got to feed this new nature needs to be fed.
Yeah, amen.
Remember, Genesis taught you, whatever's a living has to be fed. It has to be nourished. And with this new nature, will cause you suffering that you didn't have before. But it will not be intolerable suffering. Mm-hmm. You'll never be able to suffer something that you couldn't honestly say you didn't deserve. Mm-hmm. If it wasn't for what they said, I could think of 1,000 other reasons, you know.
Yeah, that's right.
Why? For myself. Sorrow in Genesis and suffering. In Genesis, God told Adam, he said, now in sorrow you're going to eat bread. Now you're going to have to work to eat.
That's right, amen.
See, that was and a woman in sorrow would bear children. See, mm-hmm. Sorrow was the result of sin. Talk about suffering. Cain killed his own brother, mm-hmm. Abel, and Ishmael mocked Isaac. Talk about suffering now. See, yeah. Rebekah was worried with the daughters of Heth. Remember when Esau married some of the daughters of Heth, and it irritated Rebekah. And said she was worried with the daughters of Heth. She suffered because of who her son married, one of her sons married. Joseph's brothers, personally, he suffered. His brothers. Jacob was oppressed by the deeds of Levi and Simeon, and they slaughtered all those Shechemites, remember. Jacob was grieved thinking his favorite son Joseph had been killed. He suffered for over 20 years, thinking it was very real suffering, even though Joseph wasn't dead. He thought he was. He suffered. Joseph was oppressed by Potiphar's wife. Potiphar had Joseph imprisoned. Jacob said of Joseph, the archers have shot at him and grieved him and hated him. See this? So in Genesis, you're introduced to people God chose. Now, these are people God chose, and they suffered. You see how some suffering was imposed because of sin, and some was imposed because of the environment, and some was imposed just because you were God's person. But you're introduced to it in Genesis, to suffering. Now in Genesis, we're introduced to God calling man. Boy, this is good stuff now. God calling men. Now, as used someplace in Scripture, like in Matthew, calling can mean invite. That is not the only meaning of it.
That's right.
It also means appoint.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
The fact that divine calling now is established in Genesis, this is something must be understood. In order to understand that God calls someone, you must understand that by nature, man's alienated from God. It's Ephesians 4:18. He's dead in trespasses and sins. That's Ephesians 2:1. All men are by nature children of wrath. Ephesians 2:3. Outside of Christ, the primary person who works in men is the devil. That's Ephesians 2:3. And we talk about calling, it's these kind of people.
Yeah.
They're going to be called.
That's right.
So it can't be because of what they've done. This can't be why the call comes.
That's right.
In time past, it's written, ye walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, that now works the children of disobedience. Even though men's vocation was assigned to them. Vocation's your calling, your job. What's what you're to do? All men are to do this. Acts 17:26. Seek the Lord, if happy you might find him. That's man's function. That's man's job. Every person is born, that's his assignment.
Amen. Yeah.
Find God. You say, well, we don't know if we can or not. You still got the assignment.
That's right.
Amen. If you take it seriously, God will help you. If you don't, mm-hmm. we won't talk about that right now.
No.
This fact, God is not accessible to any human sense. Any natural aptitude, you can't find God with any natural aptitude, because God is beyond the circumference of our environment. Book of Genesis accents this point. There, for instance, not a solitary instance from Genesis 1:1 through Genesis 50:26 where a person who had communication with God, where God didn't initiate it. There's no record in the Bible of anybody who found God without God first finding him.
Amen.
The call was initiated. See, we're talking about calling here. The call was initiated by God. Apostolic doctrine speaks of the calling of God. Now let me address the God calls everyone view. Some people say, well, God calls everybody. All right, there's a sense in which says many are called but few are chosen. There's a sense in which that's true, but that's not the only sense. When it comes to the foundational book of Genesis, no such calling can be found. Everybody was called. We have the calling of Noah in Genesis 6. God didn't call everybody. He just called one man. I say, in all the world, he called one man in the days of Noah. Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord, only Noah. And he called Noah. We have the calling of Abraham, who lived several centuries after Noah. At least about 500 years. And when he was called to go out to a place, he's the only one that was called.
Yeah.
Nobody else was called. Just Abraham was called. I mean, who doubts this? Everybody here knows the scripture. Only Abraham was called at that time. There wasn't anybody else called. And Terah, his father, had three sons.
Mm-hmm.
And Abraham's the only one that was called.
Yeah.
And Noah, his father, had many sons.
Mm-hmm.
He begat sons and daughters for nearly 800 years.
Mm-hmm.
And Noah was the only one that was called.
Mm-hmm.
Abraham was the only one. See, calling is discreet. We learn about this in the book of Genesis. There was a calling of Isaac. He was unique also. Even though he had a half-brother, Ishmael, God said, oh, I'm not calling Ishmael, I'm calling Isaac. There was a calling of Jacob. Jacob had not only a brother, a twin brother, who was older than him.
Yeah.
God called Jacob.
Yeah.
God called Joseph over all of his other brothers to sustain them. This calling, see, God's calling was unique. It's established in Scripture.
Amen.
I'm going to touch on this later, I think, but Luke lists all the generations leading up to Jesus, from Adam all the way up to the time Jesus was born, all the way up to Joseph and Mary. Now, there were millions, probably trillions, maybe billions of people born from Adam to Joseph and Mary. And Luke lists, out of all those billions, trillions, however many, 75 people that were in Christ's lineage.
Yeah.
75 people out of...
Yes.
Who doesn't understand that God chooses? How could anybody of sound mind read that and conclude God calls everybody?
Yeah.
And most of the people are listed, you don't even know anything about them. All you know is their name. That's it.
Uh-huh.
You learn that from Genesis. God calling. So if you've got sensitivity to the word God, you're seeking God, you want God, you love God, it's because you were called.
Yes, amen. That's right.
That's why.
You already mentioned this,
but it's worthy of mention again. God even gets so specific, he chooses to reveal something about himself in Jacob and Esau, and then the apostles mention this, that it was before they were ever born,
that's right.
Before either of them had done anything.
That's right.
And because he wanted this to be known about him, that it doesn't, it's by his will. That his purpose does not include our opinion about it. It's God's choosing.
That's right.
Amen.
And God, now all of this is going to be revealed in due time. God,
that's right.
In the end, with an assembled universe, God's going to, for people who couldn't see it, all this is going to be cleared up and make perfect sense of it. God not only did this, it was right for him to do it.
Yes, that's right.
Then we learn in Genesis about man calling upon God. Calling on the name of the Lord is mentioned 16 times in Scripture. Calling on the name of the Lord is to cry out for help and assistance from him. They first began to call. Adam didn't call on the name of the Lord. Eve didn't call on the name of the Lord. Men began to call on the name of the Lord. The scripture says, when Enos, the son of Seth, was born. During the time of Enos, men began to call on the name of the Lord. Now that was 245 years after Adam. Now, what I want to make here is that sin did more to the human race than people think. Adam begat Seth when he was 140 years old, and Seth begat Enos when he's 105 years old. That's 245 years. And for 245 years, man did not, according to the record, call upon the name of the Lord. That's what sin did. That's what one sin did to the human race. It desensitized them. Godward. This confirms that sin, what sin did. Then after Enos was born, the first man recorded to have called on the name of the Lord was Abraham, about 1,800 years from Enos. So here you got, in the first couple thousand years of humankind, you have two references to people calling the name of the Lord. They started in the day of Enos, and the one that's really noted was 1,800 years later, was Abraham called on the name of the Lord. Now I want to stress what sin did to mankind, so that you will know that if you've called on the name of the Lord, you have been blessed.
Amen.
That's right.
You've been blessed. You can't teach people to call on the name of the Lord. Some of us have tried. Haven't you tried? Some of us have tried with our own offspring to teach them to call on the name of the Lord. You can't teach a person to call on the name of the Lord. There's something that is awakened in them that it's this initial call of God, see, that works it. So the record of calling upon the name of the Lord, you've got when it began in Genesis 4:26, the days of Enos, and you've got two men are said in Genesis, only two men are said to call on the name of the Lord, Abraham and Isaac. Now, here's another thing you learn in the book of Genesis. You learn that God directs you along the way.
Yeah.
It's when you're walking in the in the right path, that's when the Lord directs. He doesn't give you directions like ahead of time. It's along the way. God directed Abraham from Ur. He told him, you're going to go to the promised land. Go to the land that I'll show you. I'll show you along the way. I'll show you.
Yeah.
So he directed him from Ur to Canaan, and then from Ur to Haran, and Haran to Canaan. God is along the way. God directed Abraham. Remember, he told him to offer up Isaac as an offering on a mountain. On a mountain, I'll show you. So it's on the way. God showed him. God directed Abraham's servant to find a wife for Isaac. And as he was on his journey, he was directed while he was on the journey. God directed Isaac to stay where he was at while he was living out his life for God. God directed Joseph to Egypt on the way. Now there's a further examples that we have that after Christ, that the disciples were directed while they were in the process of doing God's will. Now this, again, I don't know that this a lot of people have heard this. I think a lot of people have sensed this, but Jesus said to his disciples, now wait for the promise of the Father. He didn't tell them how long. It ended up was 10 days, but he didn't tell them how long. Wait for the promise of the Father. So what did they do? They were worshiping in the temple. They were meeting together. They prayed together. They decided. God revealed to them to select someone to take Judas' place. They were involved in the will of God. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were right in the heart of God's will. They were all together, one accord in one place. They were directed while they're in the will of God. When Saul and Barnabas and Saul were called by the Holy Spirit to a special work when they were at the church at Antioch in Syria, it says that that church had been ministering unto the Lord. And while they were ministering unto the Lord, they got the directions. When the Lord called Saul and Paul and company to Macedonia, they were involved in the work of the Lord. They essayed to go up into Asia, Bithynia, and God wouldn't let them. They tried to go into Asia, God wouldn't let them. They'd been preaching all through Galatia, and while they were doing the will of the Lord, while they were engaged in God's work, they got this call, come over into Macedonia and help us. Now, the individual that wants God to show them what they should do has got to engage in the will of the Lord.
Amen.
If what you want is for God to direct you in what you should do, that could be anything having to do with living in the world. You want God really to show you what to do, he'll show you what to do when you're doing his will. That's when it happens. So if a person lives a sloppy life, they don't really live for God, they're really living for themselves. Now don't kid yourself. God will not direct that person. Because if he did, they wouldn't know it in the first place. We learn that in the book of Genesis. We learn about sacrifice in the book of Genesis. The forfeiture of something that you possess in order to give it to God. The word sacrifice actually occurs only twice in Genesis, but the principle of it is found there. The first mentioning of sacrificing is found in Genesis 31:54, where Jacob offered sacrifice upon the mount. That's the first time someone is said to have sacrificed. We understand that there were offerings, but I'm talking about the words sacrifices. A sacrifice is something you have. It's something you own. It's something you invested in. And because of your thankfulness to God and gratefulness to him, you give it to God. This is why it was wrong for people to open up a sheep market in the temple and sell, you don't have to sell your own sheep. Come to town, we'll sell you a lamb. You can. David said, I'm not going to offer to God anything that costs me nothing.
That's right. Amen.
That's what David said. Not going to do it. Sacrifice, it starts in Genesis, teaches you about this. When the flood was over, they'd been in that ark for 1 year. Mm-hmm. For one solid year. They came out to the day 1 year after they went in. Mm-hmm. 1 year they'd been in that ark. First thing Noah did, he offered sacrifices of all the clean animals. Now you may remember that when they went into the ark, they took a pair of every kind of animal, except the clean, they took seven.
Yeah, that's right.
Remember that? Remember that?
Mm-hmm.
They took seven of each clean animal and a pair of all the others. How come they took the seven? Because they gave five of them were reserved evidently for this offering. He sacrificed it to God as he came out of the ark. You might remember that Cain offered of the fruit of the land to God. Some have said it was wrong. It doesn't say it was wrong, but because God said to offer fruit unto him later. But it does appear it didn't match this sacrifice that had to be made for the coats of skin. But it was his faith.
That's right.
He didn't offer it by faith.
Amen.
And God doesn't accept something that's not offered by faith.
Yes. Amen.
What's faith? Faith is a persuasion that God is and is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Faith is a confidence that God's God. If it's not offered to God out of a assurance of who God is, it's not accepted.
Amen.
God had no respect to Cain. He didn't respect him or his offering. God commanded Abraham to offer Isaac as a burnt offering. Now, you know how much Abraham thought of God because he didn't balk at this.
Yeah.
I know in the film Hollywood produced about the Bible, we got the actor had Abraham objecting.
Yeah.
Abraham did not object. In fact, he got up early the next morning and cut the wood and headed out. Why? Because he knew who God was. Hebrews tells us that Abraham reasoned, I'm going to offer him up. I know God said he's going to be the one, the seed, but I'm going to offer him up, and God's going to probably raise him from the dead. That's what's going to happen. That's the kind of faith Abraham had.
We see these things happening too. Until you're able to actually do things by faith.
That's right.
Whenever the Lord says to do a certain thing and you know it, then you have to you got to step forth. Mm-hmm. And as you step forth in faith, then you learn more and your faith increases.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen. See, all is revealed in Genesis.
That's right.
Things are right up to date that we need to know. Jacob offered a sacrifice on a mountain, and he had his brethren come to eat bread. That's a good place. Sacrifices are best offered on mountains, not valleys. And Jacob poured out a drink offering to God before going on with his entire household into Egypt. Jacob went to Bethel and made sacrifices to God before he went. Now we learn about an altar in Genesis also. An altar is built for use in honoring God by sacrifice or remembrance of some sort. Altars were a place of holy remembrance. The first reference to an altar is when Noah built an altar. That's the first Genesis record of an altar. After God appeared to Abraham, Abraham built an altar unto God. When he pitched his tent close to Bethel, he built another altar. Abraham built another altar. Later, God told him to go to Bethel and build to a place where he had built the altar. He said, go back there where you built the altar.
Yeah.
When Abraham went to Mamre, he built another altar. Abraham built an altar on which to offer Isaac. The Lord promised Isaac he'd bless him and multiply him for Abraham's sake, and Isaac built an altar. When Jacob came to Shalem, he bought a parcel of land and built an altar, and he named it El Elohi Israel, God, the God of Israel. Then God commanded Jacob to go to Bethel where he built the altar. He went there and built an altar in Luz. Jacob built another altar. As you can see, Abraham and Jacob were particularly noted for building altars. And Noah.
Insight and understanding is a key part of
that
altar, isn't it?
Yes, amen.
And the
reason
they did this is because they had understanding and insight about something concerning God.
Uh-huh. Yes,
so they responded
very good.
To that.
Very
That's right.
good.
Yeah. Amen. Amen.
Very good.
Mm-hmm.
Altars. Now, the scriptures tell us we have an altar. We believers. We have an altar. Hebrews 13:10. We have an altar. Whereof they which have no right to eat, which serve the tabernacle. This refers to the brazen altar in the tabernacle and temple where sacrifices were made. In this case, the altar is not viewed as a place where sacrifices are made, but as a place where we eat. It's a table. Paul refers to this practice, that the altar was a place from which people ate. In 1 Corinthians, he said, "Do ye not know that they which minister about holy things live with the things of the temple, and they which wait at the altar are partakers with the altar?" Mentioned again in 1 Corinthians 10:18. They ate of the sacrifices made on the altar. Now Jesus, when he was here, he soared over the heads of the people. When he referred to this practice and applied it to himself, he said, "Except ye eat my flesh and drink my blood, ye have no life in you." See, that was referring back to this practice of eating what was offered on the altar. To eat Christ's flesh and drink his blood has to do with participating in his death.
Yes.
That's what it has to do with. We begin that participation when we're baptized into Christ's death. Romans 6:3. We're eating his flesh, so to speak. We continue to participate in it when we bear about in our body the dying of the Lord Jesus. We're bearing about in our body the dying of the Lord Jesus. That's the eating of his flesh. That's what he was talking about.
That's right. Amen.
You're dying to self. You're dying to the world. You're subordinating your own self-will. You're placing your desires behind God's desires.
Amen.
That's eating the flesh of Jesus.
Yeah. Amen.
See, it's eating what was offered.
That's right.
On the altar. Unlike the Passover, the Lord's Supper is not like the Passover. And I know people like to have presentations of the Passover during representing the Lord's table, but this is not right. The Lord's table is not a ritual. The Passover was. It was a ritual. It was a ritual. They had to do it by faith, but it was a routine. It's a place of remembrance, like an altar. See? The Lord's Supper itself is not an altar on which something is offered, but a table from which something is eaten. So our food has to do with Christ's death to the world, to self, to sin. And we don't eat it. We just don't stand by the altar and take it. We do like the law said, eat it in the holy place. Take it off the altar and eat it in the holy place.
Yes.
So if you want Christ's life, if that's what you want, you've got to get it at the altar where he died.
Amen. Yes.
You've got to take hold of his death. Yes.
His altar also has a lot to do with fellowship.
That's right. Uh-huh. Amen.
The giving and receiving.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Participation in what God supplies.
But I saw this clearer, that it accents Christ's death.
Yeah.
Because he wasn't of the world when he was here. He's not in the world now. Mm-hmm. And so we consume Christ in this death.
That's right. Yeah.
To sin and so forth. And then life is appropriated as a result of that. And we learn about famines in Genesis. When Abraham first got to Canaan, there was a famine. When he arrived, there was a famine. Isaac, when he was in Canaan, was a famine. When Jacob was in Canaan, there was a famine. Now, The scriptures also speak of a spiritual famine, and I want to say a few words about this. Famines were always imposed. They weren't an ecological quirk. They weren't because people didn't treat the soil right. Famines were sent by God. Imposed. Now here's a famine God revealed to Amos that he was going to impose. He said he would send a famine, not a famine of bread, nor a thirst for water, but of hearing the words of the Lord. It's important now to note. He does not say a famine of the word.
That's right.
He says a famine of hearing, of hearing the word. That is, men would not speak it. Men would not declare it. God would take the word out of their mouths. It would be a famine of hearing the word of the Lord. Now, just as with famines that God sent, it was a judgment. This would be a judgment. And what Amos, in Amos, the preceding verses, he tells you why this famine would be given, because Israel had drifted away from him. Now I'm going to, it was like this. I was talking to you through the prophets. I was talking. You weren't listening. I'm going to stop talking to you.
Yeah.
You're not going to hear from me now for a while. I'm going to send a famine of hearing the word of God. Now, even during famines, natural famines, during famines, there were people were sustained. The people of God were sustained during famines.
Amen.
Abraham was kept alive during a famine. So was Isaac, Elijah, Jacob. See, they were kept alive during a famine. So during a spiritual famine, some people were kept alive. From Malachi until John the Baptist, there was a spiritual famine in Israel. There were no known prophets. There were no known prophets from Malachi to John the Baptist, a period of 400 to 500 years. It was a judgment. Because in the days of Malachi, people were robbing God. People were saying it was a burden to serve God. It was the things that bottomed out. So God dried up the speaking of the word of God. Now during the time of the new covenant, other spiritual famines have taken place. Commencing about the 4th century with the popularization of Christianity under Constantine, a spiritual famine resulted that lasted 1,000 years where the word of God was not generally heard. The Bibles were chained up in monasteries. People had heard the word read, it wasn't read in their language, and the world was robbed. Everything became dark and morose, even art during that period of time. It was a famine of hearing the word of God. As soon as the church institutionalized, as soon as that happened, the mouths of the prophets were stopped. And there were exceptions, but they were exceptions. After the Enlightenment, or the Age of Reason, another spiritual famine commenced. You know, Paul said, the time will come now when they will not endure sound doctrine. They will heap to themselves teachers after their own lust, having itch in ears. See, now you got to listen to what I'm telling you. This is the truth. When men will not endure sound doctrine, God stops sending it.
Yeah,
amen. The apostles also declared there would be a condition where churches maintained a form of godliness, 2 Timothy 3, but denied the power thereof. So they wanted to be, they called themselves Christians, but they were basically powerless. They couldn't really live above sin. They couldn't do it. Now what I'm saying is, it's up to you whether you want to accept it or not. We are living in a period of time when God has sent a famine of hearing.
Yeah, amen.
Now, everybody knows, really, that there is a family hearing. There are people travel all over the country, and it's hard to find a place where you actually hear the Word of God. If you travel up to the northeast part of the United States, it's like a desert. You go out to the north, northwest, and west, it's like a desert. You'd be glad to find something Baha'i, you know, something like that. It's a famine of hearing. Hearing. There are 40,000 people live in Joplin. A lot of them hear very little of the Word of God, proportionate to that kind of population. There are some young people in their 20s that have never been in a church service where they heard the Word of God. Why is it this way? I'll tell you why. God has sent a famine of hearing the Word of the Lord. God will not allow His Word to be trampled under people's feet. He didn't to Israel. He took the prophets away. He's taken away. Now, it doesn't mean everybody's taken away. During the time of great famine, during the time of Malachi, they that feared the Lord spake often one with another. The Lord heard it and hearkened, remembered it. So there are still people in this this is why these clusters of people here and there, there's here and there, there's little clusters of people. Why are there these little clusters here? Because there's a famine. There's a famine in the land. You can't find the Word of God every place. It's hard to find. We're just a straight Word of God. There's not some kind of a personal agenda being served, or some particular ministry is being highlighted, or some person's becoming independently wealthy over what he's doing. See? It's a famine, brethren, of hearing the Word of God. We were acquainted with famines in Genesis. God had to sustain people during the famine. They couldn't find it just every place. That's what we're experiencing that. I've experienced that. Perhaps you have too. You've been sustained, but it hasn't been at the general trough. It hasn't been at the general feeding places. That's not where it is. A famine of hearing the Word of God. Hastening along here, we find in Genesis, we're acquainted with God's displeasure. Some people prefer not to hear about God's displeasure. I personally don't want to experience God's displeasure, but you learn about His displeasure in the book of Genesis. One time it said in Numbers that when the people complained, it displeased God. In the early days of Genesis, here's God's displeasure was spelled out in what He did. Adam and Eve were expelled from the garden. Displeasure. A curse was put on Cain. Displeasure. The provocation of the decadence of humanity caused a flood to come. Displeasure. The reaction of the project of Shinar when they're going to build a tower that reached to heaven. Displeasure. The reaction of Pharaoh to Pharaoh taking Sarah as his wife. Displeasure. Destruction of Sodom. Displeasure. Lot's wife turning to a pillar of salt. Displeasure. God's reaction to Laban, displeasure, and other things. Now, knowing that God has displeasure in these things, it's very comforting and edifying to learn that salvation has to do with God's pleasure.
Amen.
Not His displeasure. See? It pleased the Lord to bruise Him. This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. Here it is. Behold my servant whom I have chosen, my beloved, in whom I'm well pleased. Fear not, little flock. It's the Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. God has placed everyone in the body as it pleased Him, having predestinated us according to the good pleasure of His will. Made known unto us the mystery of His will according to His good pleasure. It is God that worketh in you to will and do of His own good pleasure. It pleased the Father that all in Him should all fullness dwell and on and so forth. You see, salvation is based around God's pleasure. Condemnation is around his displeasure. And armed with this, now there's a certain way we should think. When we know what says in Genesis about God not being pleased, we know what's said about salvation centered in God's pleasure. So we reason this way. You ought to walk and to please God. You wonder how to live? Walk has to do with how you live. Please God. Walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing. Without faith it's impossible to please him. See, so let your life be a life of pleasing God. Then I wanted to say a word about divine choice. You've already mentioned some about the genealogy. Some object when you talk about God's choice or predestination or election or choosing. I like to argue. This sets off an argument generally. But it shouldn't. Amen. Words like this are in the Bible.
Yes.
Sometimes just when you're at home, just say them out loud. Just say them out loud.
Yeah.
Predestinate. This is the Bible.
Yeah.
Predestinated.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Foreordained. Foreknowledge. Elect. Election. Chosen to. Chosen you. Chosen in him. Appointed. His own purpose. His purpose. The purpose of him. The purpose of God. Eternal purpose. His own purpose and grace. Promised before the world began. I raised thee up. From his mother's womb. God separated Paul from his mother's womb. See, so you, this is what the Bible says.
Yeah.
You know, and no one should have any objection to it. You say, well, that doesn't mean that. Well, what does it mean, pray tell?
Yeah.
Some men debate it, but don't hesitate to accept these words just at face value, just what you know they normally mean.
Yeah,
right. Well, I don't understand it. That's not the point. You got to believe it.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, believing is the thing, not understanding.
Uh-huh.
If you believe, then you'll get the understanding.
Yeah.
Well, all of this is declared in apostolic doctrine and in the prophets as well as introduced in Genesis.
Mm-hmm.
Noah found grace, and only Noah. God chose Abraham, only Abraham. Chose to save Lot.
Mm-hmm.
Chose Isaac. Chose Jacob. Chose Joseph. Joseph was the second to the last of 12 sons, but he gave him the birthright.
Yeah, that's right.
That belonged to the first son. That was a choice God made.
Yeah.
God gave the scepter, which normally belonged to the first, but he gave the scepter to Judah. That was his.
Uh-huh.
So all through Genesis, you have this God making choices. And believe me when I tell you, you got in the same way Abraham did.
Amen.
And Isaac and Jacob and Joseph did.
Yes.
You got in the same way.
Uh-huh.
The same way you got in.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't get in because of what they'd done, and neither did you.
Yes. Amen.
Your obedience came after you were called,
yes.
Not before.
Uh-huh.
Then there's divine, yes.
God referred to as the chosen generation.
Amen. Then there's divine revelation, that of course. I list all of the revelations that are recorded in Genesis. There's several pages of them there. I just thought you might be interested in going through them. The revelations mostly were promises. Revelations are about the future. Only God can give a revelation about the future. Or a revelation can be insight into something that happened that was obscured. But you find a lot of that in the book of Genesis. In other words, God really wants you, there are things God wants you to know.
Mm-hmm.
And he tells you about things you can't presently know. He'll let you know.
Mm-hmm.
But there are things God wants you to know, and it's just not like a handful of things. It's a lot of things God wants you to know, the chief of which is him and his son and the gospel and all of the implications of it. See, all of these, we were introduced to them in the book of Genesis. So when it comes up, these callings or choosing or revelation, and someone argues about it, we've got cast in stone, as it were, examples of all of this in the book of Genesis. Amen. There it is, right there. So you don't have to philosophize about it. You can go back there and you can read where this actually happened. These things actually did happen. Now, the Lord willing, next time, and I think next time we'll have the last of our reviews, and then we're going to begin the book of Luke, is going to be the divine appearances that were in Genesis. Yeah. I'll show you how relatively few there were. Yes, Brother Jason.
Yeah, I think in my mind, I'm summarizing everything you said now, that all of these things you taught, all these points you went through tonight, these are like God was sowing seeds.
That's right, amen.
That were going to sprout later on.
Amen.
Every single one.
Amen.
And a particular importance is that promise to Abraham. God's really made that clear to me lately.
Amen.
That promise he made to Abraham, that's one of the central revelations in the whole, all the scriptures.
Amen.
It all goes back to that. Paul said God preached the gospel to Abraham.
Mm-hmm.
And Jesus is the seed of Abraham.
Amen.
And we're called children of Abraham.
Amen.
If we believe the promise. It's such a foundational thing. I can't imagine that you would even understand anything else in Scripture or the gospel or who Jesus is or what he came to do.
Mm-hmm.
Unless you go back there and you understand what God said in the book of Genesis.
Yeah, amen.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
When you see it, it seems simple, but when you see it. Yes, Brother Judah?
You were talking about salvation being a result of God's pleasure, not his displeasure. You gave the list of all those references. It pleased the Lord to bruise him. This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. And all those references are resulting of something that originated with God, which goes back to the point that you brought out in the beginning, that whatever God calls good is something that he did.
Mm-hmm.
So then in this, armed with a proper understanding of God's displeasure, the saints are admonished concerning pleasing the Lord, and you list more. You ought to walk and to please God, and so you would abound more and more. Walk unto the Lord unto all pleasing, being fruitful and increasing in the knowledge of God. And God is the one who makes himself known to you.
Amen.
And even then, that is still a work of God, for without faith it is impossible to please him. And faith is given to you by God. So again, pleasing the Lord equals a sync. When you're in sync with God and what he is doing, you're able to please him.
Very good.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
I liked when you were talking about the fruit. If you eat from the fruit that is not accepted in God's kingdom, you could spiritually get sick and die.
Mm-hmm.
And when you eat of that fruit, you won't be accepted in heaven. But if you eat of the fruit that is good and it is accepted in heaven because of the fruit of the Spirit, and you will be accepted in heaven.
Yeah.
Good thinking, Sister Hannah.
Yeah.
Amen.
You know, if somebody was standing on the corner handing out $100 bills, I think the only people that would have a problem with it were those who didn't get one.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I don't think anybody comes away from the Scriptures with a bad theology concerning election. They have to be taught that or told that. Nobody would read these accounts and say, well, God didn't choose Abraham. See, you would never come to that conclusion, and yet, If somebody tells you, well, no, but that doesn't mean, and then they add their own thinking to it, that's where the problem comes in.
They put that knot in there.
That's right.
Yeah.
The knot theology.
Yeah.
That's what Satan
that's
did.
Right.
He put the knot in
there. Yeah, amen.
Yes.
What I thought about Abraham, you know, the existence of the Jews defies all human logic.
Amen.
And Genesis, the book of beginnings, and it shows us the beginning of this people known as the Jews or Israel.
Mm-hmm.
You can't know who God is apart from encountering the people of Israel.
Amen.
God is the God of Abraham,
right.
Isaac, and Jacob.
Uh-huh.
Now, this is irrelevant for us today because there's a ton of confusion about who God is.
Uh-huh.
Everybody today says, oh, yes, I believe in God. And this is popular now to say,
mm-hmm.
I'm a spiritual person, I believe in God.
Mm.
Well, see, there's always been a lot of gods.
Yeah.
Abraham was called out of Ur of the Chaldees. They worshipped all kinds of gods.
Uh-huh.
But the scriptures teach us there's one true God. This is the God that created everything, like back in Genesis 1. Yeah. This is the God who called Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. This is the God who sent his son into the world, Jesus Christ.
Amen. Yeah.
So it's foundational.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah, I'm thankful for this book of Genesis because it's a foundation the Lord is laying. You've said this several times. The Lord was laying a foundation so that we might understand what he would say later on. And so if there's a confusion or even a rejection of what the Lord said, maybe even in the New Covenant when the apostles wrote, it was because there was a faulty foundation somewhere back here. And so I can see how the enemy has kept the book of Genesis from the people, because if they have a good understanding of the Lord in the beginning, then they're going to have a good understanding of these things like election or predestination. Mm-hmm. But if there's a faulty foundation or not much of a foundation laid, then there's not going to be a good grasp.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yes, Sister Melissa.
You spoke about the altar. I had a clearer understanding of sin being taken away by Christ. When the things were consumed on the altar, I pictured that sin was consumed. Yeah. Jesus took sin away. So when we come to the Lord's table, we remember what he did. It's only fitting that we lay down our lives as well, that we give our lives as a living sacrifice, continually crucifying our flesh, suppressing so that we don't sin. Because of what Jesus did, this is only fitting that we do this, but we were only made able to do this because of what he did. So this altar is a great remembrance for us every time we come to it.
Amen.
Amen. Yeah.
All right, we'll have a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we do thank you for this book of Moses, your servant. Insight that it gives us concerning your person. We thank you, Heavenly Father, that you have been willing to show so much of yourself to us. We know it's to the end that we might know you. And we thank and praise you for that. In Jesus' name, amen.